we're glad you're here for our midweek service. Here's what's going to happen right now. You ready? We're going to see a transformation take place. This choir is going to look a lot younger in just a minute or two, okay? They're going to exit out, and then we're going to bring our kids' choir in, and they'll sing, so we'll enjoy them. So to help that happen, you're going to help us as well. Let's stand to our feet. We're going to grab a song book, and we'll sing the choir out and sing the kids in. Turn to song number 195. We'll sing Glory to His Name. Brother Roy is going to come lead us as we sing and as the choirs transition at this time.
Down at the cross, the word my Savior died. Down, what for cleansing my sin, my good. That to my heart was a blood of mine. A glory to His name. A glory to His name. A glory to His name. There to my heart was a blood. I am so wondrously made from sin, that Jesus so sweetly abides with me. There at the cross where He could be a glory to His name, a glory to His name, a glory to His name. A glory to His name. Come to this man that's so rich and sweet, a guest that was sung at the Savior's feet. Plunge into Him and be made complete. Glory to His name. A glory to His name. A glory to His name.
You may be seated.
Mountains high enough, the river wide. I forget to say my prayers, the devil wears a grin. But he feels so awful, awful when the light comes shining in. So if you are unhappy, just don't listen to him. And just open up your heart and let the sun shine in.
So let the sun shine in. Face it with a grin.
Go ahead, give them a big round of applause. Great job, kids. And let's all stand to our feet as they work their way back to Freedom Youth Club. Go ahead and meet someone around you. Maybe there's someone visiting, watching a child or niece or nephew play, and welcome them to Freedom Baptist Church. Teenagers, you're dismissed to head out to the teen service as well. Teenagers are dismissed at this time to head to the teen service as well. While we're looking for our seats, I'll go over a few announcements. We'll get ready to receive our offering at this time as well. And so I want to remind the church of a few things. Number one, Saturday morning visitation will be at 10 o'clock a.m. Our teenagers will be having what we call one-by-one teen soul winning and visitation. That'll go out at 10 a.m. And if you can remind your kids to bring money for lunch, there'll be a sign-up sheet in the teen room at this time. Brother Daniel will have them sign up if they're going. The Freedom Kids, that group you saw right there in front of us, they'll travel to Universal Healthcare on Saturday to sing. They'll leave the church at 6:30 and return around 8:45. They'll need money for Dario, and then the permission slips as well are in the vestibule. So parents, please be sure to get one of those filled out so your child can attend. And then Public Servant Sunday is February 19th, and we'll honor those public servants in the morning service. The Freedom Kids will be singing in the service and would like for them to dress as firefighters, police officers, or EMT workers, and we'll honor those, like I said, as well, who are here in the service as we try to do a presentation for them. We'll feed them after the morning service as well. The ladies' shopping trip is coming up March 3 and 4. Sign-up sheet is in the vestibule. If you have any questions, see Annette Fischel. If you need money, see Mike Prim. Is that correct for them to go? I think that's what it says. Let me just double check here. I'm teasing. Then our youth revival is coming up for our teenagers. There's cards just like this in the vestibule. Brother Chad Watson will be preaching for us on Thursday, and Brother Scott Polly be preaching for us on Friday. We're going to have Brother Simpson and the Walters Grove Trio. They're a group we heard sing when we were in a youth meeting in Louisville. And so they did a great job. So preacher goes, we got to get them. So they're coming. And then on Friday night, we're doing a combo choir. Our youth choir will sing Thursday. And then on Friday, we're going to sing in the teens from Calvary Baptist Church over here in King. We're going to combine our youth choirs, and Brother Thomas Delp, he got one of our teen choir CDs, and he texts me and says, "Brother, I'm wearing this thing out. I want some of our teens to sing some of these songs on here too." And I said, "Hey, I got an idea. Why don't we practice them together?" And so that'll be a blessing to have them here on Friday night to sing with us. Then this also, if you did not see this, we put it on the Facebook page for the church and everything, but Miss Blanche Graham, Brother Larry Graham's mother, passed away. And so the visitation for Mrs. Graham will be on Friday, February 17th at Boone Funeral Home in West Jefferson from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. And a funeral service will follow the visitation. So please be in prayer for Brother Larry and his family at this time, if you could. All right, well, it's time to give. Let's get ready for that. Ushers, if you can come now, we'll have prayer for the offering, and let's be faithful to give. Do want to let you know our preacher is not here, if you haven't figured that out. He ran off with the piano player. He and Miss Jennifer aren't here, and so he had a meeting that he's speaking at over in Kernersville, so he just thought we'd go right along this way. And so you pray for him, he and Miss Jennifer, and then, of course, pray for us because you're stuck with me. All right, I'm sorry about that. But we've got Brother Tyler Herbert speaking to our teenagers and then our youth club going on, and then we'll have a lesson from the Word of God here in just a few moments. We're also blessed to have a missionary with us, and we'll hear more about that in just a second. Brother Barry, if you could pray for our offering and ask the Lord's blessing on the remainder of the service as well.
Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for every blessing of life. God, thank you for allowing us to be here tonight, Lord, and thank you for the blessing we've already received, both in the choir and certainly the children's choir, Lord. We thank you for that. God, I pray that you be with our pastor as he's away tonight, be with him as he preaches. And God, we're looking forward to what Brother Clint has in the Word of God for us tonight, God, and I pray that you be with him. Thank you for these good men that you sent our way, Lord, that you bless us with. God, I pray that you bless now the remainder of this service. God, I pray that you bless this offering as well, and pray that you use it for thy honor and glory in Jesus' name.
This evening, and today what we're going to do is I'm going to ask Brother Trevor Martin to come up here. He is a missionary to Montana, and he's got his wife here and the whole gang of kids, and so he's going to talk to us for a few moments, and then we have a video we'll show, and so he's going to set that up, talk to us, and so this is a good missionary family we want you to hear from, and Brother Trevor, we're grateful you're here, and again, on behalf of our preacher, I'm sorry he's not here, but he wouldn't have invited you if he didn't believe in you already, so rest assured of that. We're delighted that you're here. Talk to us for a few moments, and then introduce that video we'll see in just a second.
All right, thank you so much, church. Thank you for the opportunity. Give me just a few minutes here to kind of tell you a little bit about our ministry. As our brother said, my name is Trevor Martin. If you haven't yet, I want to invite you to come pick up one of our prayer cards. You can see a photo of my family there. I've got my wife, Tori, with us, and we have two kids, William and Henry. You know, I just want to say I'm thankful so much for my wife that's able to stand behind me in the things that we do. She's been able to travel with me. You know, many of you know Dr. Roger Baker. He's my pastor for many years. We're out of Calvary right up here in King. And he always used to tell me, you know, behind every successful man somewhere, there is a surprised mother-in-law. You know, I found that to be true just maybe just a little bit. But you know, real quick, before we show the video, I want to kind of introduce just a couple things to you about our ministry and starting a church up in Montana. You know, when the Lord first called me into missions, I always had the idea in my head that I would be in some kind of foreign mission field. That's what my thought always was about missions. But I didn't realize there were missionaries coming right here to the United States, that really the United States has turned into a mission work. And at first that really kind of struck me, you know, I thought that was kind of odd. But the more I began to dig and the more I started to look, the more I realized America is quickly becoming a nation that needs to be reached with the gospel. You know, right here where I've grown up in Rural Hall and King, I think from where I lived, I was counting the other day, I can think of at least five churches right off the bat that I have absolutely no problem going and fellowshipping with, being a member of that church. But you know, the farther west we go, we're not really going to see that. Really, the farther we get out of our area, we don't see that near as much as we do right here in the Bible Belt. So really quick, in two ways, before we show the video, I want you to show you what my burden for America is. You know, America as a whole, we're starting to see her heart turn against God. You know, in the past, we look at the history books, we see America. Man, that was a nation that was founded on God. But more and more today, if you're a Christian, you're almost kind of the oddball. You know, do you realize that today in America, the fastest growing religion is now Islam? And it's something that to think, man, really? Here? You know, in America? And then a lot of people ask me, well, why Montana? Why is it in the West? Well, another thing that we started to find, the farther out west we go, the more and more spread apart churches are starting to become. And really, the more and more scarce Christianity is. The county that we're going to is Sweetgrass County. Lord willing, we'll be moving there on May 1st. In Sweetgrass County, they did a survey. 70% of the people in that town claim absolutely no religion at all. None whatsoever. And the largest religion overall, 70% of the people that do claim something are of the Lutheran faith. So it's much, much different than what we see right here in the area. And one last thing I want to introduce to you before you see the video here in just a minute. There's a man that does a lot of church planning with B-Salt. Maybe some of you have heard this. You can go to his website and see this map you're getting ready to see here in just a minute. He has color-coded every single county in the United States. And you're going to see this map, and on there, every county that you see is red. He could not find one single independent Baptist church in that county. Now, I will say this man, he's not perfect. He's a man, but by and large, he has done a great job with this ministry. If you see a county that's colored green, he's found enough churches to reach one for every 10,000 people. And if it's yellow, it needs just one or two more just to reach that ratio, that number. So anyhow, folks, I hope this video will be a blessing to you that we see here in just a minute. It'll kind of finish out the rest of the things you're going to see about our ministry. Again, I do ask you to pick up one of our prayer cards. Remember to come by and visit us there if you have any more questions. And we do covet your prayers most of all. And thank you again, brother. And thank you, church, for the opportunity to present our ministry.
we have one Baptist church for every 570 people. There is still very much work here to be done. Sadly, many times, towns are separated by the big mountains. For someone to find a gospel-preaching church, they may have to drive several hours in one direction. The map you see here before you shows many counties throughout the United States that still do not have an independent Baptist church in them. God has called us, the state of Montana, to put a Baptist church in one of those counties. We are going to the county of Sweetgrass. We'll be planting a church in a town called Big Timber. We are currently on deputation to get us to the mission field of Montana. Once we are there, we will plant a church, and I will remain pastor of that church and further help other church planters get to the field to see other churches started in these counties. Through all of this, we will be sent out of our home church, Calvary Baptist Church, in King, North Carolina, under the leadership of our pastor, Kevin Broyhill.
Well, I'm Kevin Broyhill, and I've had the privilege of being Trevor and Tori Martin's pastor over these last 5 years here at Calvary Baptist Church, and also taught Trevor in our Bible college. Trevor and Tori is a fine young couple, and I've been excited as I've watched them mature and grow, and both of them have grown up here in our church and served the Lord. They come from faithful families that have served the Lord in our church here for years, and I'm excited about the call of God upon Trevor's life. Trevor has surrendered his life to go to take the gospel to the state of Montana. Pastor and church, I want to say thank you for considering the ministry of Trevor and Tori Martin. I don't believe you'll be disappointed with this young couple and their commitment to what God's called them to do in sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with those who do not know Him, and their desire to plant churches, disciple people, and accomplish the Great Commission right here in our own back door, which is a great mission field where our church is behind them, our prayers are behind them, and I thank you for considering their ministry.
Due to the ministries of Calvary Baptist Church, I was able to attend Calvary Baptist Bible College and Seminary under Dr. Roger Baker.
It's my delight to recommend to you Trevor and Tori Martin as candidates for the mission field. I have known Trevor for about 19 years. I've watched him grow up. I watched this young man develop character. He was saved in our church. He was later called to preach in our church. And I have the joy of being over our Bible college, and Trevor was an excellent student there. He has real character, he works hard, and I'm grateful for the part I've had in his life. He believes that God has called him to do church planting, and I believe that Trevor is one of the most sincere, honest young men that I've ever known. He has a good heart, has a burden for the ministry. And a lot of young men wait till they get to the field to start serving the Lord, but not Trevor. He has been greatly involved in the ministry of Calvary Baptist Church. And so I believe they would make a good investment of your mission dollars. He and his wife, I believe, would do well. I hope you'll consider supporting them, praying for them, standing with them as they do the will of the Lord for their lives in church planting.
We all have a duty to our great country. So many have sacrificed so much to give us our freedoms. And we have been given the task of going forward and preaching the gospel to our fellow Americans. Ask the Lord what He would have you to do in witnessing to your country. Would He have you to be an American missionary? We ask you to please pray for your country. And please pray for the Martin family as we seek to do the Lord's will in the state of Montana.
Highly recommended, of course, and so preacher will probably bring to the church and the deacons about what to do with them, but we're grateful you were here, and I apologize for the audio. We always say that's Satan trying to stop missionaries from getting out on the field whenever they show their videos like that, so if it sounded funky to you, I apologize, but thank you so much for your patience. Take your Bibles, turn to the book of 1 Corinthians, and we'll get ready for a song here in just a second. Preacher asked me to speak. I was aware of what this time of the year was and what yesterday was, and with it being Valentine's, I felt led of the Lord to speak on this topic of love, and we'll do our best to do it in just a second from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, And we'll enjoy this group to sing for us, and then I'll come back, Lord willing, and do my best to preach to you. And let's ask God to show us something from the Word of God. Father in heaven, I thank you for our missionaries that are here. I pray, God, that you would please bless this family, and what an opportunity it is to go out west and to hear that statistic about the amount of people with no Bible preaching church. And God, we can curse the darkness, or we could help this couple light a candle. And may we get the gospel out to everyone out there out west. And God, may we be faithful to get the gospel out here where we live as well. Would you bless this music we're about to hear and the message to follow? We ask these things in the strong name of Jesus. Amen. Sunday in my Sunday school class, which we talked about some Valentine's humor, I found some notes that they asked some elementary children about love and marriage and what their thoughts were. And they asked, and some of these answers are great. Alan, age 10, answered this question, says, how do you decide who to marry? And this 10-year-old named Alan said, you got to find somebody who likes the same stuff. Like, if you like sports, she should like it, that you like sports too, and she should keep the chips and dip coming. How can a stranger tell if two people are married? Eddie, age 6, said, married people usually look happy to talk to other people. Derek, age 8, said, well, sometimes you have to guess, but based on whether they seem to be yelling at the same kid should give it away. How would you make a marriage work? Ricky, age 10, said, "Tell your wife she looks pretty, even if she looks like a truck." First Corinthians 13, visitors, if you're here, you came to see the kids sing, thank you for coming. You didn't come to hear me tell jokes, I realize that, but do come back and meet our preacher and his wife, but we are honored that you're here as well as everyone else. Some of you slipped in here straight from work, and I know the hustle and bustle of that during the week, but we're glad you're here, and maybe this can be a little oasis before we get home, a little jump start for you. First Corinthians chapter number 13. Now, there's much we could look at in this whole chapter of love, as we call it. The Bible word for love they use here is charity. And I'm not trying to make you sound ignorant. I just want to make sure in case there's someone in here wondering, that's the wrong word. Charity is the same word used in the Bible as the word love. Verse number 1, though I speak with the tongue of men and of angels and have not charity, I'm become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. That's a warning to all of us in leadership. To those of us who stand and teach the Word of God on Sundays at 10 o'clock, if God gives you a platform and an opportunity, if you can speak eloquently, as he says, but we do not do it with love, we're like a sounding brass. Verse 2, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, I'm nothing. I mean, think about that faith, that you have the faith to believe that a mountain can be moved, but you do not have charity. God looks at it and says, nah, nothing. Then verse 3, and though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me little. Verse 4, charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up. On and on and on and on and on. Verse number 8, charity never faileth. Charity never faileth. True love, true charity never fails. So, millions of Americans and folks worldwide celebrated Valentine's Day yesterday. Why? You ever think about that? Why do we celebrate Valentine's Day? Is it just a marketing scheme for Hallmark and other companies to just get a big push financially? For the chocolate companies and the flower companies? Of course not. There's got to be a reason. Where did it all start? About 250 years after Jesus was born in Bethlehem, Rome was the main power of the known world at that time. Their emperor at the time, Claudius, known as Claudius the Evil, or Claudius the Cruel by others, he was trying to amass his army and get as many men as possible. Makes sense. The only problem is men didn't want to go into the army. They wanted to get married. They wanted to have a family. And back then, if you were in a family, you did not have to apply for the army or be summoned to the army. They just took all the single men at the time. Well, this made it very, very, very busy for certain priests like Saint Valentine. And Valentine would be one who would perform marriage ceremonies at this time. And you can imagine as these ceremonies were going on, the army was not being amassed, so Claudius the Cruel sent out an edict, no more marriages. You talk about an executive order, all right? And no more marriages. Well, Valentine said, yes, sir, but just could not find himself to stop marrying and ending true love. Right? And so I don't know if his services started with marriage and he went into the whole ceremony so true love could have its destiny take place. But he would find people would find him. And he then would start to find people and he would whisper, not to get caught, to break the law. If you and you have freely and deliberately chosen each other as partners for life, would you please join your hands? If you, Ralph, will have this woman to be your wedded wife, will you love her, right? And he's going back and forth. And as he would do that, he'd have to talk and whisper and listen. Were those soldiers? Okay, we're good. Let's keep going. And as he would continue to do this, he did the best he could not to get caught. Now, let's stop right there for a second. And as they say on the radio, right, we'll get to the rest of the story in just a second. Valentine had boldness He saw a cause that was greater than himself, that he just felt compelled as a priest, as an officer of this church and working here. I've got to continue to do what God has placed me here to do. And I would say this, that maybe we could learn from Valentine also, that in 2017 that we as Christians must do what he did, and that is this: boldly proclaim the truth. We must not let anything hinder, stop, or fearfully get us away from doing what God put us on here to do. What is that? The same thing he did. Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost. And to get people and to save someone who's lost, it means we need to boldly proclaim and ask them if they know if they're lost, right? You can't find someone if they don't know they're lost. And so we must boldly proclaim the truth about God's love. That's the gospel. That's what Brother Trevor's going to be doing in Montana. That's what Brother Tim Treber's going to be doing. He was here about a month or so ago, and he's going to do that in Arizona. And the over 115 other missionaries here in America and worldwide that we support are going out not to hand out vaccines, not to hand out baseball gloves or basketball shoes. They're going out for one thing and one thing only: the gospel. And if we're going to support them to do it out there, we should be doing it here. We, the church, should be doing it here. Psalm 40, verses 9 and 10 says, I have preached righteousness in the great congregation. Lo, I have not refrained my lips, O Lord, thou knowest. I have not hid thy righteousness within my heart. I have declared thy faithfulness and thy salvation. I have not concealed thy loving kindness and thy truth from the great congregation. Someday it may be illegal to preach the gospel. Someday it might be dangerous to give the gospel, but that day is not today. We have freedoms right now, and we have laws that protect us and allow us to go out. We'll take a group of teenagers out Saturday, and we'll knock on doors and invite them to church and ask them if they were to die today, if they know for certain they go to heaven. Well, that's a little personal. Well, we just love people as much as God loves them, that we want to ask them, so if they're looking, we can give them the answer. St. Valentine said, I have a decree that's been passed. I know a decree's been passed, but I must share this good news and marry these people. We as the children of God must be as dedicated and loyal to God himself and boldly proclaim the truth. Not just because it's right to do. If I can almost say it this way, it's joyful to go out. Ask any of these men that go out on a Monday night. Ask any of the folks who go out on a Saturday morning. You sit in the living room and see the weather and see this and think of your list of things to get done. And I know all of our schedules aren't conducive to do it at those two particular times. But you ask any of those and you're not going to get a grumpy face. You're not going to get a frowny answer that the kids, they're not going to go, yeah, we went out and knocked. You're going to go, man, it was a great time. We knocked on about 35 doors, our group did. Only three people were home. But of the three people, we got to give the guy. Man, there's just a joy and an excitement of knowing that I'm obeying the Great Commission. Yes. Knowing that I'm going out and being an encouragement to other church members by going out? Yes. But it's also that every now and then God allows us to cross the path of someone whose destiny is about to become changed. And instead of dying and going to a place called hell, they're given the gospel. And when they die, they'll spend eternity in heaven. And you know what's amazing when that happens? Not only do they get the joy of the Lord, but the person who told them gets the joy of the Lord as well. Anna's over here. She can testify to this, seeing her daughter grow in the Lord these last few months on teen soul winning. As sweet as Ashlyn is, and you see her sing in the choir and has a pure heart and just a love for God that we hope she continues on as we do with all of our teenagers as they grow up. But as that goes on, I remember her going out the first time. I remember sitting in the soul winning class we had for 3 weeks, and she'd go, Brother Fredericks, I don't know if I can do this. I said, Ashlyn, I have sat on a bus and heard you talk for 45 minutes straight. You can do this. It's okay, all right? No, I just don't know. So, yeah, you talk 40 miles an hour with gusts up to 80 miles. You can do it, Ashton. Don't worry about it. And then to see her the last time we went out and come with a card and say, Brother Fredericks, and give me their names and say, I gave them the gospel, and I asked them if they wanted to know that for sure they're going to heaven, and they said they wanted to know, and I got to tell them, hey, it's not just changing the destination of one person for another. It's a Christian who's fulfilling the Great Commission who says, oh, man, this is a great opportunity to serve God. You're missing out on opportunity. Oh, don't come to church. If we had this type of group sing, I'd enjoy church a lot more. No. If we were the Christians that God wants us to be, to boldly proclaim His truth, we would have more of the joy of the Lord inside all of us. 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. The gospel is a message of love, and you won't convince people of it if they don't see the same love in you. If they don't see the same love in you. Now let's go back to our story real quick about Mr. Valentine. He's performing marriage ceremonies, and he hears footsteps on the steps outside. By the time he looks around to see, the Roman soldiers are there. He turns to the couple to try to tell them to run, but they've already taken off. He's left there by himself. The couple he was marrying escaped, but he was not so fortunate. Valentine was thrown in jail, sentenced to death. Which leads me to my second point. I'm not up here saying that, listen, we've got it pretty easy in America. I know it's not what it used to be for many of you and this and that, and I'm sorry for the but it's still pretty good. We still do have some freedoms. We still do have the opportunities that other countries are still trying to come here to enjoy. And with that being said, we need to be prepared to die to self. I don't think any of us are facing a guillotine. I don't think any of us are facing imminent physical death for loving God the way we want to. But true Christianity is dying to self. And that's what Valentine said he was going to do. You know what? It may put my life on the line. It may go against the law. But man, for these people, they've got to have someone marry them. And he says, it's not about my needs. It's about their needs. And when we can get to the point, too, where we may not face a life or death situation, however, every day we do have opportunities to die to self. When you go into the parking lot at the grocery store, ladies, and you see your parking spot right there, and you get right there quick, and another car pulls up, that's an opportunity for you to die to self. Well, I got there first. Okay, I understand. But especially if you got a Freedom Baptist Church sticker on the back of your car, let's learn to die to self. I love going to Forsyth Hospital. They have about 16 parking stalls for the preachers. I hate going to Baptist. Two reasons. One, you got to find a parking spot. Two, that's worse than trying to solve a Rubik's Cube sometimes when I got to figure out which tower I'm in and how to get there and how to get back. I thought that'd be the best hide-and-seek activity for teenagers one day. I'm going to go to Baptist Hospital and we'll say, all right, go find Brother Fredericks. Ah! Probably get kicked out, but that's just a labyrinth. But do you die to self? Does it have to be your spot? Does it have to be your time? Is it all about you? Or as Christians, can we be prepared to die to self for the sake of others? It can also mean placing others' feelings and needs above your own. Now, granted, I do realize that some marriages almost have to go to divorce court because it sometimes, once in a while, we wind up trying to do too much of this. And here's where it starts. You're driving down the driveway and you do this question, Brother Todd. So where do you want to eat? Oh, I don't care where we eat, as long as I'm with you. Aww. Do you want Italian? No, I don't care if we don't have Italian. You want Mexican? It doesn't matter. All right, we're going to Waffle House. What? Oh, now it does matter. Just tell me. I don't want to have to call the preacher and get counseling. Just tell me where we're going to eat. All right, I'm going to tell this. Well, you know what? We'll go get Italian. Then about halfway to Italian, I am in a Mexican mood. Why don't you tell them? That's 3.5 miles back that way. Well, I was just dying to self. But really, that is something we need to work on, all of us. Aren't you grateful that that's what Christ did for us? John 15:13, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. For his friends. That's what Christ did for us, and let's do it for one another. If we're going to be the Christians God wants us to be and express this biblical love. Hey, we've got to proclaim the God's truth, yes, but we got to be prepared to die to self. St. Valentine was sitting in the jail cell. I don't know if he knew he was going to die that day or that week or that month. But while he was in the jail cell, it said that there wasn't a happier person in jail than St. Valentine. I mean, you talk about a guy living out his days as best as he could. Maybe it was because the many young couples that he had married previously were coming by the jail cell and they would put notes around rocks and throw the rocks through the jail bars into his room. And these notes would come to St. Valentine. And he would open these notes and read them and hear about these folks that he had married in a ceremony. Folks would come by and try to talk to him, and it got to a point to where so many people came by that they had to station guards outside there to where they couldn't even, had to stop doing that. But one of the guards got a relationship with Valentine, and his daughter wanted to speak to St. Valentine, and so the guard let his daughter go in, and they spoke a few occasions. Got to the point to where they started seeing each other on a regular basis. In fact, Valentine and he would talk to his daughter for up to hours, they said. He was in a tough situation, but he was still living with all the life that he had within him. Hey, yes, be prepared to die to self. But Christian, I say to all of us tonight, let's be prepared to live for God. Let's live for God. I don't know if we have one more day until the trumpet sounds. I don't know if we have one more week until the trumpet sounds. I don't know if we have one more month, one more year, or what. But until it happens, I'm going to live for God with all of my heart, all of my soul, all of my mind, and I'm going to love my neighbor as myself. There's not enough time to just go around moping and walking around. Yeah, well, if you knew what I went through, if you knew, listen, we could all play that game. If you knew what I went through, and if you knew what your preacher went through, and the phone calls he had to deal with today, and the people he had to return phone calls to, and the lawyers he had to talk to today, and the contractors he had to talk to today, and if you knew all that too, well, he signed up for, well, you signed up for your job, and you got the things you know. Hey, it rains on the just and the unjust. Amen. I'm sorry some of us have to go through that, but Lynn, I remind you, you don't have to go through it alone. First John 4:7-9 says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not, knoweth not God, for God is love. In this was manifested." Manifest is the Bible word for revealed, like picturing the play and the curtain coming up. It's manifest. It's revealed now. In this was manifest the love of God toward us, because that God sent His only begotten Son to the world that we might have life through Him. If we are truly living through Christ, we will walk in love. So we now as Christians should not only love one another, but live our lives desiring nothing but the best for others. Can you really say that it joys your heart to see the success of others? Can I tell you something? As a young Christian, I had a hard time with that. I'm just being real and honest with you. We were that young couple with three kids, getting along in life, trying to struggle and get through and live paycheck to paycheck like everyone else was. And then there were these friends of ours, and they would we knew the same struggles they went through and difficult times and the tough times, and as soon as you're going to get your head above water, boom, the transmission comes out of the car, and you got to go again and this and that. I forget, Brother Jimmy, the day that they came by and they were showing off their new car. I knew this couple. We were BFFs. We grew up and knew each other and this and that. And they came by and said, "Look at our new family car." And they had a Cadillac Escalade, Brother Jeff. And my wife goes, "Oh, that's awesome. Let's go see it, Clint." And I was like, "You go. I'll be out there in a second." And bro, shame on me. I was in my back living room. I was pouting. Where in the world? Oh, I bet his parents bought it for them. Did they win the lottery? How do they have money for a car like that? Shame on me. It doesn't matter. I don't care if he stole it. I should be rejoicing over them, not because he stole it, but I mean, he didn't. But I should be rejoicing over that when other people get to do things like that. Can I tell you, some of us are not living our lives as Christians because Facebook gets us upset. We look at it and go, oh, they're on another cruise? Don't they have a job? What? What do you mean they're on a shopping spree for 2 days over there? And you looking at Facebook just gets you in a grumpy mood. You know what you're not doing? You're not living, you're competing. You're competing with the Joneses. And you can't believe they got the newest and they got the latest and they got the greatest. And here we are, God. We're in church on Wednesday night and we're on church on Sunday night. When are you going to drop one of those on us? You've missed it. It's not about you. True love is always about others. It's always about others. So let's finish up this story. On the day in which Valentine was to be executed, he went to the guard and said, I'm certain your daughter's not coming by today, and that's fine, but I left a note here for her on my bench. If you can make sure she gets it. He was taken out, and there that day, AD 269, February the 14th, St. Valentine was executed, and a note left for the guard's daughter. Just signed, your loving and grateful Valentine. And that's where we get the Valentines from. And now you know the rest of the story. We've come a long way since 269 AD. And this is what Valentine sounds like in 2017. Again, from elementary school children. These were notes that teachers seized and turned in. It says this, Dear Mommy, I love you sometimes. This one says, Happy Valentine's Day, sweaty. It's supposed to say sweetie, but they spelled it sweaty. I love Mom better than you, Dad. Love, Amanda. My second Valentine is for my teacher, Miss Johnson. She's a great teacher. She's not on the Jedi Council, but is great with the Force. If you don't know what Star Wars is, that went right like there for you. Dear Mom, you're nice, you're funny, and you love me. I know your hormones are a little bit crazy, but I don't mind because I still love you. Can I remind you, church, that God himself, turn to Psalm 42. Did you know God wrote you a Valentine? It's this whole Bible from cover to cover. But I just picked out a few, and if you ever did a study on this, you could find these as well. Psalm chapter number 42. Verse number 8. Psalm 42:8 says this, Yet the Lord will command his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me, and my prayer unto God of my life. My prayer unto the God of my life. Turn over a few pages of Psalm 63, chapter 63, verse 3. Valentine's from God. Because thy loving kindness is better than life, my lips shall praise thee. Go over a few more pages of chapter 86. Psalm 86. Verse 15. But thou, O Lord, art a God full of compassion and gracious, long-suffering and plenteous in mercy and truth. Psalm 116, verses 1 and 2. Psalm 116, verses 1 and 2. I love the Lord because he hath heard my voice and my supplications. Because he hath inclined his ear unto me, therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. Let's finish this up. Go back to 1 Corinthians 13. While you're turning there, I'm going to read for you Romans 8, 35 through 39. You're looking for 1 Corinthians 13, 13. I'm reading Romans 8. It says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. You're in 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13. And now abideth faith, hope, and charity. These three, but the greatest of these is charity. I've said this to us before as a church on a Wednesday night. Faith, hope, and charity. Why is charity the greatest? Because when we get there in heaven, our faith will become sight. You won't need it anymore. 1 Timothy teaches us, looking for that blessed hope in the glorious appearing of our great God and our Savior. You won't need to look for hope anymore because you'll be with the hope. But what you will do for the rest of eternity is love. So you might as well get a lot of practice down here on earth. These Valentines from God are for all of his children. And you don't have to just get them on February 14th. You can get a Valentine from God. Every day can be Valentine's Day with God. And that love of Christ constraineth us and keeps us going one more day, one step at a time. God loved us enough that he died for us. Valentine loved the principles in which he stood for enough to die for true love. May we love God enough to be willing to boldly proclaim the truth, to be prepared to die to self, to be prepared to live for him, so we can love him the rest of the days of our lives. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for this Wednesday evening service. I'm grateful for our church and the opportunities that are provided from the nursery and the auditorium and everything in between with our Freedom Youth Clubs, with our teenagers. And God, we are without excuse. We have heard the Word of God taught. We have heard principles given to us. It's our choice. God, I pray that we would be Christians who boldly proclaim the gospel. I pray that we would be Christians who, because of the love of Christ, we would be willing to die to self. And because of the love of Christ, we would live out our days. The thief comes to steal, to kill, and destroy, but you came that we might have life, and life more abundantly. And God, if there's someone in here that knows not for certain where they'd spend eternity, if they've never become a Christian, may tonight be that night as well. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. With that being said, I just simply want to say this to you. How's your love for God? Valentine's Day.
Pastor White here. I want to thank you for tuning in to our live stream today. Whether you watched it live or on YouTube or maybe an archived sermon, thank you so much for taking the time to do so. And I want to conclude the message today by telling you a few things about how God feels about you and us in general. First of all, I want you to know today, if you're listening, God loves you. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And that means you, friend. And so I want you to know today, God loves you. The second thing I want you to know is that all of us are sinners. We've all missed a mark. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all missed a mark, every one of us. The Bible also says in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, but God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then in Romans 10:13, the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I want to encourage you today, friend, there is hope for you. There's hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you'd like to talk to someone about trusting Christ as your Savior, you can do so You can reach us at the church here at area code 336-969-6937, or you can reach us on our website at freedombaptistrh.com, where we'll have more information about salvation. And we'd love for you to let us know of your decision for Jesus Christ today. If you need prayer, if you need encouragement, please don't hesitate to call or email or visit our website. And we trust that you'll find the help needed in the Lord Jesus Christ. May you have a wonderful day, and may God bless you. Thank you again for listening to our broadcast.